Let's talk for a minute about your family. What's your husband's name and how did you meet?
Larry Daughtry from Abilene, Texas. He came to Vanderbilt on the Grantland Rice Scholarship, his first time east of the Mississippi River, from a family, a working class family, where he was the first to go to college and had thought that he would end up probably at the University of Texas, but won this nice scholarship to Vanderbilt that paid all his tuition, all his living expenses, and put him to work at America's premier racetracks during the summer, so in the name of Grantland Rice. He was 2 years ahead of me at Vanderbilt. The first time I ever heard of Larry's name, I was working on the desk at McTeer Hall, the freshman dorm, picking up a little spending money, and somebody came in and said, they've discovered who the campus creeper is. Now, the campus creeper wrote the gossip column in the newspaper, and it was anonymous. And so somehow they discovered that Larry was the person who was writing the column, and they had hustled him over to Centennial Park and thrown him in the, what is euphemistically called a lake over there. It's sort of an outsized pond that's about 2 feet deep, and this was in the middle of winter. So that was the first, and I said, well, who is the campus creeper? And they said Larry Daughtry. It was the first time I'd heard his name. He actually dated my roommate and was pinned to my roommate, and after they broke up, Larry and I became friends while he was dating Penny, and so we just kind of fell into each other's arms after they broke up and ended up getting married. He graduated and went off to the National Guard. It was that or Vietnam at the time. And after he finished his time in the Army, came back and we married.
You were still an undergraduate.
I was.
When you married.
Yeah, I was still. Well, it was that year of the first year in law school, really. And had Carrie the next year.
Carrie is your daughter. What's her full name?
Her name is Sarah Karen Daughtry. The Karen is a family name. The Sarah is too. And she was born in late summer of 1964 and turned out to be the only child we had. I was really ready to have a second child. several years later, and I said to Larry, you know, who was asking about it, whatever happened to that second child we were going to have? And I said, well, you know, I'd be glad to do the first 9 months. I said, but after that, we need to split up the obligations, and I'll do dinners this week if you do dinners next week, and you can do the bath and the bed thing this week, and I'll do it next week. We'll just split it down the middle. And And he had the most appalled look on his face. And that was the end of the second. That's what happened to the second child. It was a gleam in his eye, and then it was gone. I guess I wiped out the gleam in his eye.
Tell us a little bit about Larry's career.
Larry was an English major at Vanderbilt, was always headed into journalism. He had started writing for newspapers as in Abilene, Texas, as a teenager, and he was covering sports at the time, which is how he happened to be a perfect subject for the winner of the Grantland Rice Scholarship. So after he finished school here, well, indeed, some of the time that he was at Vanderbilt, instead of working for the student newspaper, except as the campus creeper, he actually worked for the Tennessean some. And so when he'd finished with the National Guard, he came back and got a full-time position with the National Tennessean. So our first years of marriage, I was in law school. He knew something different was going on from the beginning because there weren't many women. In fact, you know, when I started law school, I'd never laid eyes on a woman lawyer before, and neither had he. So he knew something was cooking that was not the usual, and was supportive of it, and has been all through our marriage. Been great.
If Larry was not willing to do half of all the work in raising Carrie or any other children, What did you do about childcare?
Well, I did it all. I mean, one of the things that happened at about that time was, you know, we had been told that we had to make a choice between a career and a family, and there was that generation of us that just gritted our teeth and said, you know, you're not going to tell me I can't do it all. I can do it all. So that's exactly what happened. There was that famous night when Larry was sort of, you know, he'd come home from his job and read the evening paper and watch TV while I was cooking and cleaning up and bathing Carrie and getting her to bed. And so one night about 9 o'clock, I'm over there doing the dishes in the kitchen. We didn't have a working dishwasher. And he's sitting there reading a book. And all of a sudden it just hit me, you know, and I said, why am I washing these dishes? I mean, why didn't you wash the dishes while I was upstairs, you know, doing it all with, and he looked at me and he said, famously, he's never lived this down, washing dishes is sissy stuff, which apparently is what he got from being raised by his mother in Texas. And so I kind of went through the ceiling. And we had a little rocky period of time.
Was that the closest you ever came to divorce?
Probably, yeah. I'd say it was the closest. It just, you know, that's how most women came to the new women's movement, though. It was some sort of thing like that that just hit you, and all of a sudden the light goes on, literally, and you're seeing what you didn't see before. So that was also about the time that we didn't have the second child. So.
Tell us a little bit about how Carrie has grown up and what she's doing now.
Well, Carrie, the sweet heart of my life, did, in fact, the story about that I embarrassed her with recently in making a little talk for Women's History Month at her office. She's an assistant U.S. attorney, the same office that I was in all those years ago. And they invited me to come over and speak, and I was talking about the fact that while there wasn't daycare, there were one or two little schools in town that would take, nursery schools that would take them not only for the morning, but feed them lunch and let them take a nap. But in order to get a child into one of those little schools, they had to be out of diapers. They had to be trained. And so the summer that Carrie turned two was the summer I wanted to go back to law school. And so I said to her, we're going to learn how to do this. And we've got just a couple of months to do it. And because I want to go to law school. And so she had a little pressure about it. You know, you're not supposed to potty train them under pressure. But I was under pressure, so she got under pressure and survived it nicely. I mean, she's been a wonderful success ever since. And she finished university school here in Nashville, graduated, and went to Vanderbilt undergraduate. And then she studied engineering. She was in the engineering school and had a triple major in computer science and electrical engineering and mathematics, and was headed into technology and ended up in law school, happily, I think, and was a John Wade scholar at Vanderbilt Law School. And her last semester, she was an intern in the district attorney's office doing domestic violence work, and just realized she had a calling to that. And so instead of going with a law firm, which is where she thought she was headed to, she went to the DA's office and did domestic violence work there, and is now in the U.S. Attorney's office doing child exploitation work. So.
You're now a grandmother?
Yes.
Tell us about your granddaughters.
Carrie kept waiting for Mr. Wright to come along, and he didn't. So at about age 35, she applied to adopt a child from China. And we went over and got Maddie in 01 and went back in 07 or 08, I'm not sure which, to get her younger sister, Chi-Chi. So I now have two grandchildren, both of them born in China, different parts of China, and Carrie definitely has her hands full. Mr. Wright still isn't there, although I tell her If he does show up, we'll know he's not Mr. Maybe, because he'll be signing up for more than most men would, I think, be willing to take on.
Do you think Carrie chose a career as a lawyer because she saw you as a role model?
Well, I don't know. You know, she used to come over to my office when I was teaching at Vanderbilt Law School. She'd come over in the afternoon from university school, which was sort of across the street and down the block a little. And she watched the law students struggling, especially the women law students. And her position was, I am never, never going to law school. So it took her a while. And what convinced her was she was out in California interning at Hewlett-Packard in Cupertino one summer and had some friends out there who were in law school. And the Casey versus Planned Parenthood opinion came down from the Supreme Court, and she noticed immediately that the law students were all so interested in it and talking about it and analyzing it, and the people at work didn't even know, you know, the guys with the pocket protectors at work didn't know it had even happened. And it suddenly, as she called me and she said, you know, all your friends that you have that I love so much, all of them are women lawyers, and I think that's what I want to do too. I want to go to law school. I had never encouraged or discouraged it. If it was going to happen, I wanted it to be her choice, and that's how it worked out.
After you were at the district attorney's office, mm-hmm. and you'd moved from General Sessions Court into the trial courts, what was your next job and what caused the transition?
Well, you know, after several years of watching what went on in the courtroom, it occurred to me that the job I really wanted was not as an advocate, but as the umpire, so to speak. But at that point, I'd never laid eyes on a woman judge. There wasn't one in Tennessee as far as any of us knew. It seemed like a sort of a pipe dream. And I went and talked to Frank Gray about it. He was a district court judge in Nashville at the time and also a family friend. And
he was also from Franklin, wasn't he?
He was also from
Franklin. You have a lot of Franklin connections.
Yeah, I do.
including
me. Connie Clark.
Excuse me, I digress. Go ahead.
Anyway, I said, you know, what do you think the possibilities are? And of course, he had really no idea. You got to be a judge in those days, mostly through political connections. And I said, I've got this offer to go out and teach at Vanderbilt. Maybe that would be the next thing to do. He encouraged it. Vanderbilt was trying to hire, the law school was trying to hire a woman because they were under pressure from the Department of Labor. There were virtually no women on the campus anywhere at Vanderbilt at that time, and that's 1971. Except in the nursing school. When I was there, I don't know what your conception was when you were on campus, but there was a woman who taught in the math department. I had her for math. There was a woman who taught in the biology department. There may have been a woman or two in the romance languages, but really, that was it.
There weren't many more by the late 60s.
No, there were none in the English department, none in the history department. I mean, so you can understand why the interest in Washington grew. So they were under pressure to hire a woman, and it was that, we would hire one if we could find a qualified woman kind of thing. And even though most law schools don't hire faculty from their own graduates, I think it was probably Carl Warden that brought me to John Wade's attention. So Dean Wade agreed to let me have a tryout. And that was because Carl Warden said, well, she can co-teach criminal procedure with me, and I'll keep an eye on her, in effect, and make sure that, you know, this isn't a complete catastrophe. And so that's how it started out. I was a lecturer in law for a year, teaching criminal procedure with Carl. Actually, we weren't teaching together. He would just give me certain segments to teach, and I would go in and handle those, and he would do the others. We just kind of split it up. And it was fine, apparently, because they then offered to give me a full-time position the following year, and that's how that happened.
How long did you teach at Vanderbilt?
It was 3.5 years, and they were just forming the tenure committee, my tenure committee, at the time the opportunity to go on the Court of Criminal Appeals arose.
And tell us about how you came to be a member of the Court of Criminal Appeals.
Well, at that point, and still is, it's a merit selection process. There's a commission that recruits and vets the people who are interested and sends names to the governor. So I got into it, and fortunately there were a couple of lawyers on that committee that were not only to whom I was a known quantity. Bill Willis, I guess, was my main promoter on the commission, and he knew Larry. His law firm represented the Tennessean, and Larry's mentor, of course, was John Siegenthaler, and they were all pretty much friends, which is, of course, also how I probably came to Gil Merritt's attention early on. It's the old thing about contacts is absolutely true. You've got to have the qualifications, but you've also got to know people to get the opportunity to show that you have the qualifications. So I made it onto the list. I had come to the governor's attention because I was on his Blue Ribbon Screening Committee. This is Governor Blanton. After he was elected in 74, he formed his Blue Ribbon Screening Committee to help him find qualified people for his cabinet. And there were token folks on there. I was the token woman. Washington Butler was the token African American. Jim Neely was the token union person. I mean, we knew why we were there. When the notion of putting a woman on the bench, and there had never been a woman on a court of record in Tennessee, and so somebody sold Ray Blanton on the notion that he could become a first himself, the first governor to appoint a woman to a court of record in Tennessee, and I don't know how they managed to sell him on that, but they did. And so he had offered to appoint me if my name came out on the list, if I made it through the process. I did. I got the appointment. So,
what year was that?
That was 1975.
How many years was it before a second woman was appointed to any trial court?
Six years. In the meantime, there was a woman elected up in Clarksville to the General Sessions Court, and she ultimately became a judge on a court of general jurisdiction, Carol Catalano. Unbeknownst to us at the time, there was a woman who was a juvenile court referee up in Upper East Tennessee who probably can claim to have been the very first Shirley Underwood, the very first law-trained woman. But she was not sitting on a court of record, so that's the difference.
Do you have a story about getting fitted for a robe?
Yes, the robes in those days came from a menswear store called Joseph Frank and Son. And old Mr. Frank was old. I mean, he really was old. And I wandered down there. I was working on a project with the Supreme Court at the time. I was on a commission that was developing the Rules of Criminal Procedure. And I took a break from that and went down the hill to Mr. Frank's emporium, and since it was at noon, his seamstress was not there, and so he had to take all the measurements for the robe, and he was stunned. I mean, the first question was, I don't know what you call a lady judge. Should I call you Judge-S? And I knew at that point that it was going to be a little rough in one way or another. So then the next question was, how long did I want the robe? And I said, I don't understand what you mean. How far off the floor, he said. And I said, well, how far off the floor do the men have their robes? 8 inches, he said. I said, 8 inches, that's just, you know, that'll be fine. And we figured in, you know, an inch or two for the heels that everybody wore back in those days. And so then he started taking the measurements, and he took the arm length, and he took the length across my back, and then it became time to take the chest measurement, and I could see he was getting increasingly nervous about the whole thing. Eventually, he got the tape around the middle, and it sort of fell off one side. I could tell he was not going to pick it back up. So I was a little nervous about the robe coming. Fortunately, it's gathered in that area, so it was going to fit anyway, but I had no idea whether he'd gotten it right or not. Then he wanted to know finally, did I want buttons or a zipper? And I didn't know, so I got to a telephone and called Joe Henry, who was on this commission with me and on the Supreme Court at the time. I said, "Joe, what do I want on this robe? Do I want buttons or a zipper?" And Joe said, "When you're at home at night and you're wearing a robe for comfort, what do you like the best?" And I said, "A zipper." And he said, "Well, that's what you want." And so to this day, those silk robes that old Mr. Frank measured me for, I still have two of the three of them. One of them disappeared over in Jackson. Keep an eye out for it. That's only been 20 years ago, or 17. And the one in Cincinnati is in tatters. I mean, it's 35 years old, and it's got lots of air conditioning in it, and I simply refuse to have it replaced for sentimental reasons.
Your office was in the Tennessee Supreme Court building.
It was.
Where we're sitting now. Most people think of appellate judges as being isolated. What was the day-to-day routine like?
Well, it was sort of isolating. It was a secretary at the time and a law clerk, and that's who you saw mostly on a day-to-day basis. The person on the court that I was the closest to was Bill Russell, who lived in Shelbyville, and Bill came up here and had an office in the building and came up regularly, but the job would have been even more pleasant if he'd been here every day. He was the one that really helped me make the transition from the law school onto the bench, and he was probably the most generous and really affectionate mentor that I had all the way along. He was simply wonderful. I miss him very much.
Did your other colleagues accept you?
Not entirely. I hadn't laid eyes on a woman judge, and neither had they, and it was just a little rocky to begin with. But, you know, it all sort of worked out in the end, I have to say. It was good to have Bill Russell, though, to sort of keep the waves from crashing over me a couple of times.
Was there any training for new judges then?
None. But there were the seminars, the twice a year educational seminars that were run. The first one I went to down at Henry Horton Park, I think it made Bill Russell very nervous. He didn't want me to stay at the park, and took me home with him to stay with him and his wife, Nell Lacey. I think he was a little afraid of what might be said to me if I was left down there without a chaperone. And so for several of those meetings, I stayed with them in out in the country where they lived.
There are some stories about judicial conference. Do you want to tell any of them?
Well, they used to be, you'd have to say, I think, whether they have become more staid in the years since then. About 35 years ago, the judges got away from home, and there was a little carousing that went on at the state parks, even though alcohol was normally not allowed. And there was at least one occasion where I got to my room, turned off the light, and pretended I wasn't there, and ignored people beating on the door saying, "Come out, come out. You know, you're not having any fun in there by yourself. Come on out here and let us buy you a drink," kind of thing. Things changed over the years. People got much more professional, and I'm sure it's totally professional these days.
Do you remember the first case that you ever sat on, or the first opinion you ever wrote on the Court of Criminal Appeals?
I don't think I remember the very first one, but early on in my tenure, I did get a case from Memphis in which the trial judge had denied probation to in a two-bit burglary case where somebody passing through, hungry and cold, had broken into an unoccupied dwelling just so that he could spend the night. And the sort of hard-nosed judge down there in Memphis had denied probation in the case. Nobody had ever been reversed for denying probation in a case. And I, sitting with Bill Russell and another one of my colleagues, I'm not sure I remember who it was now, did reverse that and send it back so that this out-of-state person could be put on probation, didn't have to go to the penitentiary. Apparently that was one of the reasons that Bill Russell was convinced that I shouldn't be left alone at the state park a month or two after that. I think it was a topic of a lot of discussion among the trial judges, that not just that they had gotten reversed, but they'd gotten reversed by this, you know, sassy woman who was only 33 years old and uppity girl kind of person. So,
what other cases on the CCA do you consider your most interesting or most important cases?
Well, there was also one at about that time that involved actually a district attorney that down south of here, who was actually an acquaintance of mine and a friend of my husband's, who the state versus judge, and he had, in arguing to a jury about the defendant in closing arguments, had said, you know, and furthermore, you've heard all this, and then there are things about this guy I wish I could tell you, but the rules of evidence won't let me tell you these things, and the jury convicted, and it came up, and I wrote an opinion that is still cited, and not only in Tennessee, but I noticed got cited in some Sixth Circuit cases recently, saying that you can't do that. You can't rely on something that you know and argue that to the jury, that it's denial of due process to the defendants. That sort of didn't make me very popular either with the district attorneys around the state. So I was, you know, never afraid of sticking my neck out a little. And so that was interesting. I was one of a number of people who tried to get the two intermediate courts consolidated. One of the problems was that the criminal cases tended to get run of the mill after a while. And the other problem was that most of the people that went up to the Tennessee Supreme Court came from the Court of Appeals with absolutely no background in criminal law at all. So that there was one year, I recall, that the Supreme Court, as part of its discretionary appellate jurisdiction, took only six criminal cases in the entire year, which was definitely not enough. And we worked at trying to get the two cases, a few of us trying to get the two courts consolidated, and it was a pushback from the civil judges that kept that from happening, and it, to this day, it still hasn't happened. And it was until the late 80s before anybody from the Court of Criminal Appeals did become a member of the Supreme Court, and then several of us after that with criminal law experience got on the court. Made a difference.
One general question. Do you enjoy the intellectual process of writing and analyzing appellate
opinions? Oh, yes. I mean, that's, if you don't, you don't have any business being an appellate judge. I never have handled a trial. I'm sure I would probably enjoy it. It has its own excitement, but it is the sort of academic work that the appellate courts do that really has been my home.
Martha Craig Daughtry was the first woman to become a member of the Tennessee Supreme Court. How did that happen?
Well, it happened because, that is a story I'll have to tell and tell quickly. I hadn't really thought about it. All the judges in Tennessee, as people watching this probably know, take office on the same day in September every 8 years. there is no staggering unless somebody steps out of office during the 8-year term. And so the Supreme Court was going to be up for re-election in 1990, and I was up in the summer of 89 in New York teaching, as I had for years, at the Appellate Judges Seminar at NYU, and Margaret Bem called me, and I had to find a payphone out on the street, this is before cell phones, to call her back, and she said, in effect, to make a long story short, we want a woman on the Supreme Court. It's 1990s coming up. We think it's past time, and we're giving you first refusal on running for the Supreme Court. And I took it. Most people have been able over the years to get me to do a lot of things that probably were crazy by saying, we need a woman, we've never had a woman do this, and we need a woman, and I fall for it every time. But the truth is, I'm quite sure if I hadn't done it, the next person in line would have been Connie Clark. And Connie, you were on the Democratic State Executive Committee at the time, which was the group that that actually did the nominating. And so the problem was that there was an incumbent in office, a respected incumbent, a very conservative sort of judge, but somebody that a lot of the sort of older lawyers in town held in great esteem. And in order to get on the court, one of us was going to have to run against him. And I guess Margaret convinced me to do it. And it was...
This was not precisely a merit selection
process.
No,
it was not a merit selection.
What was the selection process for
this job?
Well,
it was partisan. In addition to the fact that it was an open election, it was a partisan election. So it first had to get the Democratic nomination and then run against any Republicans that might be put up. And so the job was that I had in front of me, having agreed to do it, was 6 months of canvassing the Democratic State Executive Committee members, 66 of them across the street, across the state, 33 women, 33 men, from Memphis to almost to Mountain City, not quite to Mountain City. And I spent 6 months going from door to door, in a sense, and talking to each member of the committee. It was a fabulous experience in terms of getting around Tennessee, not just meeting these people, not all of whom by any means that I knew, but also going places that I never would have gone otherwise, because the point was to get to them in their home areas. Lots of wonderful stories about it. But in the end, it worked out that I had something like, I think, 50 votes among the 66, and there were like 6 or 8 people that didn't show up in the long run. So it was a big victory. And
to close the circle, I didn't get to vote for you. Do you remember why that was?
No.
Because I was appointed circuit judge.
That's right.
Before
you got on the bench.
We actually
you went
got
on the
to
bench. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly true. But you were supporting me, which I valued very much. And so when it became your turn to go on the Supreme Court, I was the happiest person in the state about it. Happier than anybody else you know, because I always felt like I had gotten your seat on the Supreme Court in the first place. And so I was very, very pleased about it.
Well, that's not true. But you have always been completely supportive of women who were seeking judgeships and other leadership positions. Has that been important to you?
Oh, totally important. One of the things we did was, I remember talking to a woman who was the founder of the National Association of Women Judges and finding out from her that there were like, this was back in about 1979 or 80, that there were 125 women judges in California, which just knocked me out since I was at that point still the only one in Tennessee. And I said, how did you do that? And she said, well, Jerry Brown, the governor, appointed most of them. And I said, because he just thinks there ought to be all these women judges? And she said, no, it was because the women's bar associations went to the governor and lobbied. And I'm saying to myself, women's bar associations, now there's a good idea. And so Subsequently, almost immediately, we formed the Lawyers Association for Women in Nashville, and later the Tennessee-wide group, and actually used materials and people that the National Association of Women Judges sent to Tennessee for us to use to put on So You Want to Be a Judge seminars, training seminars for people that wanted to do that. It's always been important.
You became a member of the Supreme Court in 1990. What were the most important issues, administrative or legal, before the court then?
Well,
and how'd your court react
to
that?
There were just, we did have a new majority on the court. Three of us came on new on a court of five. I had campaigned on a couple of issues. One was the establishment of an authentic administrative office of the courts. And I'm proud to say that ultimately you became the head of that office.
The first woman.
Woman to do that. I mean, there had been this little staff of somebody called the executive secretary to the Supreme Court before that. And when I started on the bench, there were two people, the executive secretary and an assistant. And that just isn't the way it was being run in most places around the country, which I knew from all the work I did with the ABA. So I was firmly behind that. And then the other thing was ADR, which we had very little of in Tennessee. One of my colleagues that was running with me at the time asked me at some point, he said, I just talked to so-and-so down in wherever, and they said you'd come through 2 days ago and you were talking about ADR,
and he looked at me. And what does ADR stand for?
Alternative dispute resolution. And so he turned to me and said, what is this ADR? So that's sort of where we were with alternative dispute resolution in 1992. And so those were the two administrative things that I ran on. And while I was on the court, we got mandatory continuing education, and that commission set up. We got the rules revamped, the rules of procedure revamped, the rules of evidence established. There was a lot that went on during that period.
How old were you when you took office?
Let's see. I was 33 when I went on the Court of Criminal Appeals, and so 15 years later, I was 48 when I went on the Supreme Court.
How long were you on the Tennessee Supreme Court?
3.5 years. I was not looking for another job. I think in many respects it was the best job I ever had. I was crazy about most of my colleagues, liked the work a lot.
What case that you wrote is the most important?
Oh, well, the frozen embryo cases, undoubtedly.
Is that Davis versus Davis?
It was the quintessential case of first impression, because there was nothing anywhere. There were people involved in vitro fertilization in various parts of the world at that point, Australia, Europe, here in the United States, but there was no legal precedent of any kind when the case came to us. And it was, in effect, a custody case. They had had this couple had had the embryos stored while they were still together, and then divorced or separated before she ever became pregnant. And there were these embryos left over, and the question was what to do with them, and they couldn't agree. She wanted initially to keep them so she could be implanted with them, and then she got remarried in the midst of all the litigation, and her new husband wasn't interested in having her ex-husband's embryos implanted, and so then she wanted to donate them to a childless couple, and the father, the would-be father, the male progenitor, had been raised in an orphanage and simply didn't want children that were his procreation out there in the world somewhere where he didn't know about them. And it was a, you know, sincere objection to what she wanted to do. And as a result, they ended up in litigation, and it came up to us.
What did you decide?
Well, we decided that as Rush Limbaugh noted later, the father won. Rush thought I was a hero because the male actually won the case. I think he may have recanted it someplace along the line. The interesting, and it was based on the establishment of the right to privacy in the Tennessee Constitution. That's what the case actually stands for. That there is a right to privacy that the male progenitor had the right to invoke, the ability to control his own genetic material, and the ability to say that he didn't want those embryos implanted into somebody who was not his own wife. The interesting story behind that is it got a lot of national attention, and we did have the press out front when the case was argued over in Knoxville. And Lyle Reed, who was the Chief Justice at the time and was making the assignments of who would write what case would write the opinion that in the cases that we heard. And we took a morning break. We took a mid-morning break after we heard the arguments in that case. And he said, you know, I really don't know how to assign this case. So I'm going to ask that any of you that are interested in writing it, pass me a note at lunch. And I'll decide then this afternoon to whom the case should be assigned. And those wimpy men. I was the only one that said, I want to do it. I really want to do this. And so I got it by default. But it is what I call a tombstone case, where they put on your tombstone, if you have one, she wrote the frozen embryos decision. So
what difference did it make to have a woman in deliberations about that kind of case and all your cases?
Oh, well, I tell the story about when I left the Supreme Court, a friend of ours who was the managing editor over at the Knoxville newspapers called me and said, okay, so you're leaving the court, the first woman's leaving the court, what is your legacy? And I was struck by this, and I said, you know what, Tom, I'm going to have to call you back. I'm going to have to think about this and call you back. So I go out to Pat Norman, my secretary, and I said, we've got to come up with a legacy here. They want to know what my legacy is. And thinking about it for a little while, I called him back, and I said, I think it's surprisingly enough the domestic relations cases, because it was an area of the law that had simply been, the criminal law had been too, but that part of the development of the law in Tennessee had just simply been ignored for years. It wasn't important to the men, and in a couple of cases where they did take those issues up, they decided them the wrong way. So that was terribly important. The other thing that was going on while I was on the court was implementation of the state constitution. The judges who were on the court before us, with one exception, really, and that being Joe Henry, were not interested in the movement that was going on across the country at the time to look at the state constitution and as well as the federal constitution in deciding cases. So we hit a lot of precedents, particularly in criminal law at the time.
Did it make any difference that your court sits in three different grand divisions?
Well, that was decided in 1835 or something when they put it in the Constitution then that the judges would travel instead of the lawyers.
Is there a difference in the kinds of cases or in the lawyering that you see?
No, not really. But it probably was good that we got out and saw some other parts of the state. I think the current court and the court after I left carried that out even further with different kinds of projects around the state. We even set up a swearing in various parts of the state instead of making all the new lawyers come to Nashville. The Jackson, as the place where the Supreme Court met, was set up in that 1835 Constitution, because at the time Memphis was just a little river town of absolutely no consequence at all, and Jackson was a big commercial area for cotton and other kinds of agricultural products. And so the people in Memphis felt very sort of ignored because the court went as far as Jackson and no further west. And so on several occasions we went to Memphis and actually sat in Memphis, which the Memphis bar appreciated, I think, very much.
You did not live in the same city with all your colleagues. There was not a requirement that everybody
right.
live in Nashville during your tenure on the Supreme Court. Did that make any difference in how you communicated with one another?
Well, in those days, yes, we didn't have as much face-to-face communication as some of us would have liked, because it meant that people had to come in from out of town. As I understand it now, the court's using video conferencing to a great degree. And that's good, because you get face-to-face discussion fairly frequently. I don't think probably you get as good a feel for your colleagues as you did when you could argue with them around a table all morning and then go to lunch together afterwards, or have a drink in the evening together. So I think probably that's missing. On the other hand, I think the court's probably having intercourt communications more frequently than we were able to do before.
After 3.5 years of an 8-year term on the Supreme Court, you were not looking for another job.
Yes, what happened? And my husband at that time was covering the Clinton-Gore campaign. And at some point along about October before the November election, in 92, Al Gore said something to Larry about, what about Sissy on the Sixth Circuit? And Larry said, well, gee, we've never discussed that. I don't think she's looking for a new job. And Gore said, well, maybe she ought to think about it some. And I was sort of surprised when Larry came home and repeated the conversation. But in fact, the more we thought about it, the more it seemed like it might be a good possibility. I really think the work with the Supreme Court was tops. And I've said it even to my colleagues on the Sixth Circuit. It was the best job I had. On the other hand, trying to run again for office, especially in the wake of the Penny White debacle, I hope you all have talked to Penny White. It had been a wonderful experience the first time I did it, but it had produced a lot of stress-related health issues for me, and it just seemed like a challenge I didn't need to go through twice. And here was this nice lifetime tenure job calling to me, a little raise in pay, not a lot, but some, and sort of a new challenge at a point where I had been on the bench for 18 years and doing the same really sort of work, and this looked like something new and different. And I took a shot at it.
Because you accepted that challenge a very short time into your Tennessee Supreme Court tenure, hadn't been eligible at that point to become Chief Justice.
Right.
Is that a regret?
Not at all. The Chief Justice that we had the whole time I was on the court, Lyle Reed, I thought did a wonderful job. There is the funny story, which I've told publicly, so I'm not telling secrets, at least not for the first time. When we all got elected in 1990, the question was who would become the Chief Justice, because he or she is chosen by the members of the court and not elected as such or appointed by the governor or other ways that it's done in other states. And the interesting thing was that each of the men voted for himself. And that meant I got to pick the Chief Justice. And so, you know, it's a feeling of power and accomplishment when you cast a vote and there it is. So it fell to me to choose. And I thought Lyle Reed did a beautiful job, and I'm sure others did a good job after he was finished with his term. But that was how he became Chief Justice.
You came to the Supreme Court in 1990. It's 2010, 20 years later. Today, the court has a female Chief Justice and a majority of members who are women, and this Chief Justice will be succeeded by a second female Chief Justice this September. How does that make you feel?
Well, it's so fabulous that when Janice Holder became Chief Justice, and indeed when Sharon Lee became a member of the court, I mean, it was beyond anything I ever could have imagined. Now, some really astounding things have happened over my career. If anybody had told me when I was in law school that I was going to become, that I'd someday sit in the chair that Harry Phillips was sitting in, at a point where Harry Phillips wouldn't even hire a woman clerk, I would have been flabbergasted. But even in 1990, if you had told me that there was going to be a majority of women on the court, or a woman Chief Justice, or two in a row, I would have said, you've got to be dreaming somehow. The first court, Supreme Court, that had a majority of women on it was the Minnesota Supreme Court. I'm not sure what year that was. But we were all so encouraged about it and really happy about it that there was this threat that we would, the women lawyers of Nashville would rent a bus and drive to St. Paul and just sit in the back of the courtroom there and watch this happen in front of our very eyes, a court that reflected, you know, the world as it really was, and then file out, get back on the bus, and drive back to Nashville just so we could see this happen. And now here it is happening in our own state. It's fabulous.
When you went to the Sixth Circuit, you encountered a first of a different sort in terms of women colleagues. What was that?
Well, I had some.
It was the first time you weren't the first.
It was the first job that I had ever held where I was not the first and only woman there, and it was really grand. Cornelia Kennedy had joined the court in about 78 or 79, and Alice Batchelder, who's now the chief judge, had come on a year or two maybe before I got there. So I had two colleagues on the court, and then Karen Moore was the next appointment after mine, and so there were four of us on a court of 16, which is you know, almost like the real world.
Tell us about your early or most important cases on the Sixth Circuit.
There's not a case that I've handled on the Sixth Circuit that sort of has the frozen embryo prominence to it. But there are some cases. There's been at least one Title VII case that turned out to be important, the Williams case, that had to do with sexual harassment on the job. That was important. There was a dissent in the case involving the federal criminal charges against David Lanier, chancellor down in Dyersburg, Tennessee, that turned out to have some, was one of those dissents where the Supreme Court says, hey, you're right, the dissenter is right, and that kind of makes you proud of the work you've done. And there have been some election cases that have been important, but I don't know that there's a single case that I can point to that I think is a tombstone case, to use my own
phraseology. And how does the day-to-day work differ from your work on the Supreme Court?
Well, it is back to being an intermediate court again. Instead of picking and choosing the cases as the Supreme Court does and taking the cases for some really important reason, not just to correct errors that might have happened at trial, but because you're trying to develop the law, Here I am now, back on an intermediate court where you take what you get. I mean, it comes flying at you. There's lots of it. You're working on the case that's in front of you, doing the best job you can, getting it off your desk, because there are, you know, 16 more that are coming in. And most of it is dealing with legislation from Congress, so it's statutory interpretation for the most part. I think the thing that I've said that struck me the most about going to federal court was the cases seem to come in bunches. So that when I first got there, I got hit with this run of ERISA cases. And I have to tell you, I didn't know anything about ERISA, and I could have spent the rest of my life not knowing anything about ERISA and been just as happy. So I get this run of ERISA cases that are just sort of a mystery, really, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what have I done? I gave up this good job on the Tennessee Supreme Court dealing with all kinds of law development and important constitutional cases, and here I am, you know, with ERISA. But then the next bunch of cases that came in were a good run of First Amendment cases. And so I said to myself, aha, well, this is sort of what I was hoping for and what I expected. So it's a much broader, in a sense, it's a much broader range of cases simply because the legislation coming out of Washington is so broad. And every once in a while we run into a new statute that we just simply have not seen before. But that's the kind of sort of work it is. None of the common law development, none of the tort law, none of the domestic relations law. Most of the criminal law is sentencing issues now, really. So it's apples and oranges compared to the Supreme Court of Tennessee.
Federal circuit judges are nominated by the president, but they must be confirmed by the Senate. Today we see some hearings that are pretty contentious. Your confirmation process was not without interesting events.
It was. Patsy Cottrell, who's now on the Court of Appeals, was the head deputy over at the Attorney General's office, called me one day as the confirmation process was going along in Washington and said, you know, this group called Free Congress, somebody from this group just called me and wanted to know if we would join them, if our office would join them in opposing your confirmation. She said I was struck dumb and said, well, of course we're not going to do that. Why would we want to do that? And apparently it had to do with the death penalty cases that the Tennessee Supreme Court was deciding at the time. And that was, in fact, what the opposition centered on was the positions that I had taken on death penalty cases. At that point, however, I hadn't ever written an opinion. I had simply joined them, and many of the ones where the death penalty, I think there, by the time I was confirmed, we had decided something like 13 death penalty cases, and most of those where the sentence of death had been reversed were unanimous opinions where all five judges had joined in. So it was not me on some kind of personal crusade against the death penalty, but that's the way it was interpreted in Washington.
How long have you served on the Sixth Circuit? What's your status today?
I have taken senior status. I did that about a little over a year ago. This is my, I guess, my 17th year on the court. I became eligible for senior status after 16 years. My caseload has gone down some. The number of clerks that I have has gone down some. But the days still seem to fill up with work. I'm a little amazed that I haven't really felt the supposed ease in the amount of work yet.
Your colleagues on the Sixth Circuit come from four states, and most people maintain primary offices in their hometowns.
Right.
You sit in Cincinnati. What kind of relationship do you have and have you had with colleagues over the years who are much farther removed geographically and philosophically.
It's true. I mean, Detroit is a long way culturally from, say, Memphis, Tennessee, or Chattanooga, Tennessee. But in a sense, that's what makes the work interesting, is that you're dealing with, as colleagues, different folks from different legal cultures and backgrounds. And to the extent that we're applying state law in cases, it's not just Tennessee law anymore, and which makes it certainly more interesting. There have been difficulties on the Sixth Circuit in the past few years that have been largely attributed to the political background of the presidential appointment, and it has been unfortunate in many respects that exists. But the Sixth Circuit's not the only court where the division along political lines has occurred. I must say, none of that ever happened in the state court that I'm aware of. We had on the Court of Criminal Appeal judges from that were dyed-in-the-wool Democrats from West Tennessee and dyed-in-the-wool Republicans from East Tennessee, and it just sort of never made any difference in the outcome of the cases, either on that court or the Supreme Court. But on the federal circuit courts, it can happen.
You've always had a special interest in judicial education, and you have a long-time relationship with New York University and the school they have there for appellate judges in particular. Tell us about that.
Well, I went up there in the summer of 1976 as a student at the appellate judges seminar. The law professor who ran that program had been a visiting professor at Vanderbilt while I was on the faculty there, and so I was sort of a known quantity when I got there. That, by the way, that group of about 18 or 20 appellate judges from around the country included the first woman judge that I ever laid eyes on, Sonia Morgan from the Court of Appeals in New Jersey. And I was asked back to join the faculty the next summer in 1977. And except for a couple of years in the early 1990s, I've been on the faculty up there ever since. And it's been a real joy, because I've met judges from all over the country and served on the faculty for long periods of time with the same really great judges from around the country. It's been a joy.
What's the most important quality for a good judge to have?
My first pick would be open-mindedness. Others might say temperament or intellectual ability. To me, the whole thing is about being open-minded as you approach the cases and open to the lawyer's arguments and not given to deciding an issue before you see it in the context of a case. I think that would be my first strike.
As my next to last question, what things would you like to talk about that I may not have asked about?
You know, I think you've covered it all. It may be because we know each other as well as we do, but I'm going to get out of here in a few minutes and think of about six different things I wish I had said, but right now I'm sort of speechless.
Martha Craig, Sissy Daughtry, you are a role model to many people. And there are many people who thank you for the careers that they've had. What would you say, though, is the single professional thing, not your family, but the single thing that you would most likely like to be remembered for?
I think it is having been the first woman in so many places, the one thing that I was absolutely committed to was getting the next woman in. So I appreciate what you just said, because it was very important to me that I not be the queen bee, the one and only. It was so important to me that others come in behind me. And I'm proud to say that in almost every case, I've had something to do with the next woman in and the woman after that. It is, I mean, for instance, the Lawyers Association for Women here in Nashville, what a wonderful thing to have been involved in establishing. I just saw the most recent newsletter, and I have to tell you that except for Martha Trammell, who was in at Vanderbilt when I was there, I didn't recognize any of the possibly 15 young women who are moving into the officers' positions and the boards of directors, the board of directors, first and second year. I don't know those young women. And in a way, that's sad. In a way, that's, but it is what we wanted back all those years ago, and it was very slow in coming. It was much slower in happening than I would have thought possible. But when it happened, it really has changed. And there are women everywhere in the profession now. There are still some mountains to climb. Numbers of women in the very highest positions in the law firms looks to me like, especially in Tennessee, they haven't been as successful as we've been on the bench, actually. So there's still places that need some polishing. But for the most part, that's been really important to me, and I hope I can be remembered for that.
And I know you will. Thank you. Mm-hmm.